Introducing. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the sixth and the last of these series of talks on roots as part of our cultural heritage. ICOMOS began as an international platform for the protection of heritage, and today, through its various initiatives, has become a community to exchange on different ways for recognition and conservation of our collective heritage. The Charter on Cultural Roots, led by the International Scientific Committee of ICOMOS, has paved the way for creating new frameworks. We, as a national body, must find our own methods and ways of seeing cultural roots in our context. Through this year's theme of shared cultures, shared heritage, and shared responsibilities, our NSC is sharing six specific case studies with the primary intention of bringing forth key questions and a framework to create our own methodologies. The last five talks have highlighted the vast resource bank that we already have and also identify the gaps which need to be looked at for a holistic approach. We have seen that our heritage roots embody multiple associations and meanings, layers of hidden values, old and new forms of communication, connects active and passive perceptions for us as conservation professionals, as well as people directly under their zone of influence. Today's talk is about the vital linkage which brings nature and culture together. Presented by Xavier Benedict, the cotton root today is integral to the identity of the nation over time. It will take us through maritime trade and traverse through several monuments and sites that are integral to it. Beginning with his work in Pulicat, since 2007, Xavier laid the foundation of ongoing protection of one of the largest water lagoons. The ARDE Foundation, led by his wife today, supports almost about 120 families in the region. While this is going to be recognized as one of the natural reserves, he says, we invite him to share his journey since 2014 on the recognition and research on cotton root. As usual, requests everyone to mute their audios and videos until the talk is concluded, followed by a question-answer session. Please type in your relevant questions in the chat box on the right of your window, and welcoming Xavier to begin with his presentation. Hello, Xavier. Take over. You can take over.
Hello. Good evening. Good evening. And I'm audible to all? Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Tapan, is it okay? Fine. Shall I start?
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
Yes.
Thanks for the opportunity. And this should not be the last. This should be the beginning of all the roots, and it should be the beginning of the cultural values this country possesses and going to flourish forever and ever. And this today's topic is cotton root, which is very close to my heart. For a long journey, I am traveling in Pulicat, in closer to Chennai. It's a water body. Before starting my talk, I want to ask a question for which everybody can give an answer at the end of the session. This is the first slide you are seeing with a title called Cotton Root with my name and the date. On the left-hand side, you are seeing two question marks. I want you to answer what color and how this color is brought to this cloth. This cloth is called Pulicat cloth. And right now, this cloth is not in India. It is in a museum in America. And it's a long stretch of cloth with a lot of pictures on it where the Portuguese and an Indian guy negotiating prices. And this particular cloth is dyed with particular natural colors. My question is, from where that color came from, particularly the reddish brown or brownish reddish colors. Blue already you all know. I want you to know where is this brownish color tint came from. So this is how it's going to start, and it's going to be a journey where I want you to, if there is any clarification question, please put your question and I'll answer it at the end of the session. Thank you. Yes. Why? And that is what my question is, my journey in Pulicat. This is a small office and small museum kind of setup in Pulicat, which is located on the north of Chennai at 55 kilometers north of Chennai. And this particular place, we got a small setup to give all the information about the land, about the water body to the public. And every year we conduct a program called Trace Origin of Madras as part of Madras Week. And that week celebration photograph only you are seeing on the left hand side. This particular Trace Origin of Madras title is given because the entire history of modern administration in India, particularly European administration, was started in Pulicat only. That's why we are putting it a title called Trace Origin of Madras. And the left right hand side of the slide, you see a nice prayer tower where you will call people call for prayer at the mosque. And this is a nice feature which is seen in the any ancient mosque in India. And this particularly a Tamil mosque. I'm putting the word Tamil mosque because there is a lot of history and heritage surrounding that. So this is how I started. I started in 2007 to conserve the water body as my aim. Then I stumbled upon many things. And finally, now we have a passion and the pride to continue to talk about cotton root. In our mission, we have coined a word called Save Pulicat to Save Chennai. That also you will come to know in the middle of the session. In 2010, we published a book called Pulicat and Sadras. Because Pulicat and Sadras are closer to Chennai, Sadras is in the south of Chennai and Pulicat is in the north of Chennai. So we published this book in partnership with the Anna University School of Architecture and Planning, with lots of research, with the support from the National Archives in Hague. And on your left hand side, you see a small picture with a lot of couple of men sitting and discussing. It's nothing but a picturization of the first meeting of the largest multinational company in the world with Shas. 17 members came together and they came up with a company called VOC. In English, it is called Dutch East India Company, which was started in 20th March 1602. This is the first company in the world to issue shares. And that's how the stock market is started in Amsterdam. And you should be, and we should be very proud that today, whatever you saying as shares and stock market, the largest thing was, the main reason was the journey to India to find cotton. That's many people may be surprised by this, but yes, it was the journey they started for sharing. Shares issued for journey to find cotton in India. And if I say India, India is not a one country as such in that about 500 years back. It was believed that it was land beyond Indus. And sometimes even scholars confused it up to Japan. So that point you have to note it. So this pride journey, this is because of this book, we stumbled upon many, many, many things to it. Then we came up with a cotton route. And I am not the only person who got this idea. It was given to me through a couple of people. And the main person is, light is working slowly. Yes. There's a main person. Let me talk about the main person. Next slide. Sorry, there's a little bit of confusion. I want you to find, what is the linkage between all these pictures? Spend your few minutes on this picture slide. There's a nice linkage between all these pictures. One is Kenya and Nigeria. One is about Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh. One is about Japan. One is about Mexico. One is about Egyptians. Then there's a nice, beautiful guy, Xavier, in Vietnam, Ho Chi Minh City in Vietnam, where I'm giving presentation to a couple of my colleagues in Vietnam. And where I'm wearing a cloth, a lungi sarong, which I bought it in Vietnam itself, near to the border of Vietnam, Cambodia. On your right hand side, you'll see the Dutch petticoat. And on the top, you see a logo, a symbol, emblem, a label stuck on the lungi or a sarong sold in Malaysia. So I've already told the word called lungi. So there is a big connection here. The connection is none other than cotton. And you see Sabarimala there. It's in the word Pallikattu Sabarimalaikku. That's the word they use very commonly in Tamil Nadu. Pallikattu is nothing but pulikat. So the Japan, they still have a link with pulikat. The word called pulikat is used. Palayakar. The word Palayakar is used. Am I audible? Yes, okay. In Mexico, the bandana, it's instilled in Pulikia. In Mexico, it is called as Palayakat. And this particular Kenya, Nigeria, it has got a bad history behind it. So let us not look into it right now. But this is the Madras checks, they call it. It's nothing other than the cloth originated in Madras region, which is Coromandel region. So there is a nice linkage. And this Egyptian linkage is far long stretch, which is more than 4,000 years. The white cloth, they wear it. They wear it. We can see the history in Indus Valley Civilization, in the Tamil Sangam literature also, and in Indonesia also. And you can see all this linkage all over the world, from Mexico to India to Peru to everywhere, with one cotton, where it has all started with this. Till now, the research proves that it is only started from Coromandel Coast because of the technology and the weaving and spinning technology. So there is a link. So that's how it's cotton root idea, which I want to link it with. This is how I started for the word called cotton root, because many of you may not notice the word cotton root in Wikipedia or internet or in research papers. When I was reading the book Spice Root, published in 2005, which is, I would say, a republication or this is one of the books which was published in 19th century, which is republished, I would say, with a lot of content in it, with a new publication with John Key. And that Spice Root raised a lot of questions about Indian Spice Root. That's how I started. By the time I published the book called Pulikat and Sadras in 2011, someone called J.C. La Stephen called me. I was surprised. He said, boy, you are doing a wonderful work, and it's a gold mine. Pulikat is a gold mine. That's what the word you used. And the same word Mr. Sanjeev Raj also used a botanist. And J.C. La Stephen he's a author of this book called Oceanscape, which was published in December 2014. That was a game change, and that was a change in entire my life also, because the book gives the detailed history about Tamil textiles in the modern world. And the quantum of numbers, I would say the numbers of tons of cotton which left this coast, you can't imagine that much cotton. So then this question of overlap, spice root or cotton root, then the cotton root question started. And it's all, the base was the 1997 book on Coromandel Coast and Interlands, Economy, Society and Political System. What J.C. La Stephen did was, he's from Pondicherry, right now he lives in France. He did a wonderful thing of translating all the Lisbon documents. From 2008, 9, 10, he translated all the Lisbon documents from Portuguese to English. He speaks more than 7 languages. That's how it's all, we came to know about the entire thing. This is how it all started as a cotton root thing. And then the book on Dutch East India Company, that gave us the idea of the empire called Dutch Empire, then the British Empire followed it up. So this is how the journey of Pulikat or cotton root started. But today's presentation, you will not see much of Pulikat, but you see much of Coromandel Coast only. By the time, cotton root became very famous because of this Oceanscape book, that book you saw in the middle, that book became very famous. The government of India ordered about many copies, I think 2000 copies of the book, and distributed among all the embassies of India around the world. So can you imagine the trustworthy document and the trustworthy details in it. So all the embassies received that book. By December 2016, India's government said cotton route to counter silk route. It's a for me it was like a wow, what you are doing is this, but not no no connection between me and government of India, but it is all started like that. So that book, J. Sila Stephen, who published it in 2014, was a game changer in this. As you all know, the coast of Coromandel Coast has got a long link with the southeastern nations. More than, of course, there was a long link between the Gulf countries, but there's a linkage between the southeast nation for a long time. It goes back about 1000 BC. But recorded history, which is the Sangam period history, which was didn't have any kind of evidence, solid evidence. By 2015, when Keeledi excavation was started, which is equivalent to the Indus Valley Civilization's excavation, many things revealed, and particularly the Chola, pre-Chola, before, during the Sangam period, pre-Chola trade routes were vast and expand up to the Japan region, China. We have so many evidences of temple scriptures and temple stone scripture, manuscripts, and everything is there. So the Kandaram, then Sri Vijaya Empire, everything has got a link with this region called Chola Empire. And Gangaikonda Cholapuram stands evidence to that. And you might have all seen this big temple called Bragadishwar Temple in Tanjavur. This all stands evidence for the large expanse of our the coast and also the history of the trade. So Sangam literature found evidence in 2015, then all things started upon in this cotton route. Hello? Suddenly this slide is... Yes,
your
slide
screen
is
gone.
Now it's
no,
seen?
We can't see this.
Now it's
no.
Available?
Yes,
is it available
yes.
Now?
Yes.
Yes. From my, that is okay. I gave one similar to this topic about a week, 2 weeks back. And in that, I saw in the same picture. This particular Southeast Asian trade, past stretching up to Japan, China, and Indonesia, Malaysia, in particular temple in Indonesia, Borobudur Temple in Central Java, Indonesia, you see a nice stone inscription with a picture of a Tamil boat or ship. In that, you will see three sails. This is where the thing all very important, three sail. These ships, very common in this Bay of Bengal and the Indian Ocean, became very quite famous among all the empire, all because of the one reason of this cotton cloth of sail. The reason is it can withstand all this strong wind. So dynasty in China, Vijayanagara Empire, Sri Vijaya Empire, then all this empire near the Mesopotamia region, everybody was curious to know about this. That's how the Arabians also, from Arabia region, arrived in India, and particularly this coast. We have many evidences to say, state that. 1281 Chinese in temple, there is one Tamil inscription to state how the trade were. So this particular boat is one of the big, most important evidence for us to show how this sea trade were. Yes, above all, the champions of champion in the maritime trade is none other than the Arab traders. And after the Romans were very particularly about, I would say, on land traders. These Arab traders were perfection in terms of understanding the wind movement. So that was a big thing. So this Arab traders, they came to the coast of India by catching the coast. They just catch the coast for every short distance and reach India. And by having a good relationship with the south region of India, they established a strong route for which we have thousands of evidences, thousands of monuments and everything. before Islam they came in, and after Islam they traded. Till today, they were called as a Mama, Mapla, Macha. That is a Tamil word. In Malayalam also Mama is there. It means uncle, brother-in-law kind of relationship between a Hindu trader and a Arab trader. The reason is intermarriage, interreligious marriage or inter-community marriage was happening. So everybody was considered them as not like today. Everybody was considered as a Mama, Machan, or a brother-in-law and uncle. You believe or not, in my young days, I used to use the word called Macha or Mama with my Muslim friends, family friends. But unfortunately, lately, it is not like that. It's changed a lot. The word cotton came by from the Arabic word called kuton. I don't know how to pronounce it. Q-U-T-U-N. So the cotton word is origin is from Arabic language. So the Surat to Calcutta, everything was joined with catching the coast. By the trade, they learned the monsoon traveling. That is by the wind movement of the monsoon. We in India, we have two types of monsoon. By that, they started traveling. So that's the big game changer in the things. So you know, yesterday you saw the spice route, how Vasco da Gama came in and everything. There is a big story behind it. I will talk about that in the next slide. This is, I want to show the evidence of monuments. It might sound very English or Dravidian style, but a mosque. This is a mosque in Tamil Nadu, particularly the southeast coast of Tamil Nadu, Kilakarai. And on your left, you are seeing one of the oldest mosques in Tamil Nadu, ranging about 1,200 years. And most of the mosques are either modified due to ignorance of the importance of architecture or due to the size of the congregation, and many things were changed. This particular mosque is clearly shows our unity in diversity. Dravidian architecture, many, I don't think it, you can see such things in Gujarat and in Dhaka. But in Tamil Nadu till today, we have many mosques, even in Pulikat, in Sadras, many mosques we have in stone mosque, which is a Dravidian style. Don't link it with any other last decades of history. This is a very much older, 400 years. But there is a contention with which is the oldest, because yesterday they said there's one mosque in Kerala, it's the oldest. There's a lot of question about that, because in Tamil Nadu, people are arguing that we also have the oldest one. Okay, let me not get into that now. But this is just to show you how the trade were and how strong it was, how it was linked with the, our culture and our lifestyle. Yes. This is the picture, I put it in a poster, so everybody would have seen it. And yes, up to 15 knot knot till the date where Vasco da Gama landed in our country, the Europeans thought cotton came from sheep plant, because they have only sheep, they have lamb, and so there's sheep plant, everything grown in the plant only, even the pod will give birth to sheep, or a sheep is grown in the plant. The many pictures like this, till up to 1539, Royal Society of London was arguing and questioning and everything. The main reason is Arabs were not letting to tell everybody where the cotton came from, how the cotton came from. They know this, Romans knows it, and they know, they got the idea from the Arabs in the region of Mesopotamia region, or Iraq, Iran region, or Russia, Mongolia region. But nobody knew where the cotton grew, how it was growing, how it was cultivated. But this imagination of cotton came, and it, everybody was looking for the cloth for one reason, which I'll show in the next. We know Lungi and Shara, sarong was one reason, but this is the biggest reason, which I'll show in the next slide, couple of slides. But everybody believed until up to 1539 that cotton came from sheep, which is a plant sheep. So this is, sound may sound very funny, but it's true. There's a document to prove it. Yes. They were searching for the cotton for only one reason: the mighty empire to expand. In one book, H. Lee only documented the sheep plant and everything. Here's the book, you can read it, and it's a downloadable in Google. India, however, continued far in advance of every European country in spinning and weaving of cotton to nearly the middle of 18th century. You have to note this. India was like a huge, India, I would mean not only the country today you're seeing, it is a subcontinent, including Sri Lanka and every other region. And the reason they landed is because of this cotton cloth, which they can put as a sail in the large, mighty ships. Till up to medieval period, Europeans were using only a one sail kind of thing. And then they have multiple sail, and each claw sail can withstand about 8 months of journey, which is a big, big game change in that. They can cross the continent, they cross the ocean in one journey. They don't need to catch the coast. Now you can understand, catching the coast is not necessary anymore. Vasco da Gama came, yes, of course he came. And the journey we took, because of his nice, intelligent way of bribing a Tamil merchant or Tamil sailor in Zanzibar and one particular part in Africa. I don't know whether it is Zanzibar. And he took that person and got the idea that there's a sail, and these things worked out very well with him. And they took a journey. And by the journey, 1498 to arrive in Calicut, within a couple of years, we are able to see a lots of trade on the southeast coast of India, particularly in Pulicat. Not only in cotton, lots of rice also was taken from in Pulicat and delta region of Nagapattinam from 1500. On record, it has been shown in Lisbon documents. On the slide, you are seeing this particular sail. Now you can see the numbers has increased. The push thrust on the sea ocean has been increased. The size of the ship also increased. The quantum of loads they can take on the ship also increased. And the mighty empire's vision also getting established. So now we can understand how this thing called colonization was playing a major game. But personally, it is nothing to tell anybody that I have a proof and all. There's a little bit of doubt from my side about the Columbus journey and Vasco da Gama journey, because I think both are glorified for certain reasons, because there are many evidences to prove that there was a journey between the African region to India through sailing across the ocean. But these two heroes, Columbus and Vasco da Gama, yes, of course, we learned in our books and we have to believe in that. Yes, this is a slide which I took it from Wikipedia, because I was a little bit lazy to make this slide. This will clearly show the mighty empire's vision to expand to the East India, the nation East Indies. As per record, during the 1502, the Portuguese landed in Pulicat. 1502 is particularly a reason, because this is the journey Vasco da Gama visited country. But he didn't come to Pulicat. I don't know. There are many other reasons. It will take another long journey for me to discuss about that. In this slide, you see everything on this. You see many lot of things on this coast. You can see many lot of things are happening on this coast. Few things. This is due to the spice, because spice was taken to this coast during the one particular monsoon. And this is the export monsoon of cotton. And this is the later part, and the catching the coast traces are there, Surat, Bombay. And this particular coast, which was already established in the Southeast Asia, and the Europeans now found the route, they were crossing beyond Sri Lanka. They couldn't go through this way. There are only a couple of evidences to show that they crossed this region. So now we can see this. I'm going to show you the next slide, which will connect you from the empire to the nature. Hope you all observing this slide very much. And this here you can see the date, and it gives you French, Dutch, Danish, English, and now I have evidence of Spanish, Italians landing here. Yes, this is a very common slide which I show it in every talk I give. From the previous slide, you can understand the nature culture linkage. The culture, I mean colonialization culture. Yes, This slide is I taken it from BNHS, Bombay Natural History Society. I'm a life member in that society. In one of their paper publication, they published this to show all the important wetlands in India. It's not just a wetland, it is a game changer in India history. Unlike the Western Ghats, this is the Western Ghats region. In this coast, we don't have much Eastern Ghats. It's all scattered, or it has all been demolished to lay road or palaces or a fort. And this region is purely lived by the wetlands. So the cyclone, during the cyclone get attracted due to the moisture of this wetland. It's not like where the southwest coast of India, where the southwest coast monsoon hit the mountains and the rain will fall on it. So this region, you see lots of wetland, and with that you see lots of delta. You don't see much of, or you don't see any delta in this region. You see only delta in this region. And now we can think a little bit. Delta is good for cotton. Egyptian delta cotton. India delta cotton are very expensive. That is, sea side cotton is very expensive than the land side cotton. So delta wetland played a major role in this cotton route, which is a nature given. Largest producer. So any ancient maritime traders also used the movement of birds and the turtle to navigate. They did have all this compass and telescopes, but the movement of bird played a major role. So delta and wetlands are very, very important in our life for the rainfall of India, as well as in history. It played a major role in terms of occupying the country or colonizing the country. On the same slide on the left, or on the right, you see Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu were with the Buckingham Canal map, which connecting Kakinada to Pondicherry, which is called as Coromandel Coast. British has laid it by connecting existing canal to transport all this wood, cotton, all the rices and everything. One thing you have to know, we have lots of evidence to prove that there is a rich rice export taking place from this region, particularly Delta region of Tanjavur. Yes. So this slide is very important, and just I'm going to show you this again. This is Kakinada region. This is Visakhapatnam. This is, and this is Yanam region, which is a French. This Pondicherry, Mahe, Pulikat, Sadras, Nagapattinam, and unfortunately Thoothukudi is missing. I don't know why the Thoothukudi has been taken out, but Thoothukudi also played a major role in terms of trade. And Colombo had a one Dutch connection, and then the British took over from 1825. Yes. So monsoon, the word monsoon itself is an Arabic word. Whether it is a mosum or musim, I don't know how you pronounce that. So the word monsoon is an Arabic word. So it played a major role in our trade. There are two types of monsoon, southwest monsoon and northeast monsoon. Southwest monsoon was, in my consideration or in my belief, it is a import wind, and northeast monsoon is the export wind. The wind will push the ships away. Whole load of cotton will be pushed out to the sea and they have to go. According to the wind pattern, they will move and do that. But you have to, you see this 1 year, this I am not exaggerating, southeast monsoon, 25 states in India live with that. Depend on that. 25 states in India, southeast monsoon. There is only one region, particularly Coromandel Coast, which is part of Andhra Pradesh and full Tamil Nadu, live only for northeast monsoon. We are completely dependent on the northeast monsoon, rich in cotton growth, rich in delta. But unfortunately, due to many other things, many things fell apart and things went off in a bad way. And Pulikat became the first administration that I put in the slide. And this I also put it like cotton grows in delta, which is I already mentioned before. This picture on your right hand side shows the 2015 wind movement during the northeast monsoon. And this I'm not exaggerating on my own, about the 40 years of data procured by the IIT Kharagpur proves that eye of the cyclones falls on the wetland. So where is Coromandel Coast? The major Coromandel Coast is from the Kakinada to Nagapattinam. This is the shadow region. This is the region where it ends, where the southeast and northeast monsoon, southwest and northeast monsoon meets. Pulikat is here, Chennai, then we have Machilipatnam, Vijayawada, then there is a Vishakhapatnam. This is a shadow region also. This region have major of a black cotton. Sandy loamy soil is good for cotton growth, and Delta is the most best for that. But unfortunately, after almost about 19th century, American cotton took over the entire thing, and it has played a major role in terms of diminishing our trade, diminishing our farmers' income and everything. There are three types of cotton in popular. One is called Dhaka or Calcutta cotton, and another one is called as Mumbai cotton or Kutch cotton. And then is the Coromandel cotton. Coromandel cotton, there were varieties, but in the late last 100 years, this history has been vanishing, taken off. There are many varieties, and from the good to bad, good varieties to the poor inferior varieties also. And inferior varieties are owned by the slaves. So there is a big record about slave trade between Pulikat and other region of the world, from Suriname in South America to Malaysia to Reunion Island near to Seychelles, which I don't want to talk about it. The one important thing I need to talk about is Coromandel. Many people interpret as Cholamandalam because of the Chola, but there is a scientific proof and also a historical document saying this Kari Manal Made. Kari means black, soil, high ground. So when you see from the seaside, you'll see a slight blackish coast. That's why the word called Kari Manal Made originated. The slide which has got on another stone, which is says ECC, East Coast Canal, Buckingham Canal, 25th mile. From Chennai to Pulikat is 25th mile on the boat. So this is one of the first in Asia, in India, only in canal to have milestones. It's a beautiful thing, but unfortunately, nobody knows where the remaining stones are. Luckily, we have protected this 25th milestone, and it's lying there. Let us see how long it can stay that in place. The mighty empire, yes. Dutch were the mightiest in terms of trade up to the 1825. The first was the Portuguese. This I took it from somewhere, I should have mentioned it. This is the mighty empire where they are taking cloth and silk and indigo and pepper and everything for exchange of gold and silver. And up to 1715, 23% of the world GDP of this entire world GDP was around this region only. I have a beautiful slide showing how even the land route of India were coming towards the Coromandel Coast. But I'm not showing it today because it's not, it will confuse you for the cotton routes trade. So this you have to believe in this. But many people have questioned what's the Dutch has got to do with India? Yes, Dutch had a major trade in India. And the largest empire company called VOC, established with the shares, was functioning very beautifully. The British got very envy. So they started their British East India Company. 1825 was the game changer. They made a treaty between themselves, between the British and the Dutch, saying that they will take over this region and the British will take over this region, and with making the Singapore as one of the major transit point. Now we can see the spice islands where all the, except pepper, everything goes here. From here, they take it, exchange for cotton, and they go. Or take the journey over here. And the Japanese come here with their gold. Japan was one of the largest producers of gold. They come, exchange gold, and they leave from India. So this is our thing. And 1825 particularly mentioned this word because there was a very large volcanic eruption in Indonesia, a place called Tambora, the Tambora eruption. It was the largest eruption ever in the human history, 1815. And 1815 was a very significant history where many things happened during that decade, with the death of Tipu Sultan in 1799 to the Waterloo battle in England. Everything ended up. So by that time, this volcano eruption also came in, and it was the largest and the biggest in the world, in the history of the world. And that created a big thing, because for about 4 years, there was no more summer. There was no sunlight. That's what the exaggeration historical record says. There was no summer. And as you know, this Christian mentality where they say, okay, end of the world, the empire decided and they split into two major colonies, Dutch colony and the British colony. That's how it's all split. 1825 was a game changer. By 1825, Dutch left India and everybody left India except the French and the Portuguese in a small colonies like Pondicherry and Goa. And the British started their thing. And by the time also, East India Company lost their power. All the power of administration went into the Queen. Now you have to note it. So 1825, and the nature always proves their power. Now it is proved also. Now we are sitting in and listening to this slide because of Corona. I think in another couple of years, we'll see another different world order. I don't know what it is going to be. Yes, this I want to show. This is one of the rarest picture to show the size and the magnanimity of this place called Pulicat. The town of Pulicat in 1669, drawn by Johannes Wingboons. He's a Dutch cartographer. If a city is like this, you should imagine how would it would have been in 500 years back. Yes, of course. A major trading port, and that the major trading port was supported by the lagoon called Pulicat Lagoon. It's very important. These lagoons are very important. That's why the delta is very important. All the ships are wooden ships. They can easily anchor in that in this sandbar. Smaller ship take that load and come into this coast. If there's no sandbar and if it is hitting the coast, if there's a rock, it is dangerous for the wooden ships. Now we can understand why people are preferring this lagoon point. It's whether it is Pulicat or Machilipatnam or Nagapatnam or Koyalapatnam. Everywhere, the Patnam word means port, we'll have a lagoon or a estuary. Estuaries are very important for the wooden ship to anchor. So the nature culture played a major role. Nature and economy plays a major role till up to we found the steam engine and electricity. So now this, and see the size of this entire thing. This particular is Fort Gilria, the first fort of Dutch in India. 1610 they completed it. This is a temple. They call it as a pagan thing. Building looks like a European, but it's a temple. Till today it is there, because whatever is other than Christianity, they call it as a pagan god, and so they drawn this. This is a mosque. It still today exists there. This lake, water body, everything still exists. Actually, this is a drinking water till up to 20th century. Unfortunately, that particular Dutch cement fort was destroyed a long back. So this is reconstructed by us, and we did an excavation, not we, ASA did an excavation and proved it in 2013. There is a big evidence about it. And this is a colorful picture. I need to run through because I have a lot of other slides to show. This is a colorful picture of this large port called Pulicat Port. And you can see this people are getting hanged, slavery due to slavery and all. Unfortunately, in 1825, the British demolished it completely, thoroughly, this evidence. They don't want the Dutch evidence to be in India, because then only they can write their own story called history. What they left over is the cemetery, the largest cemetery, I would say, with many tombstones. There are two cemeteries. One is called Portuguese cemetery. We call it as old cemetery, and then it's called new cemetery, Dutch cemetery. This is the new cemetery, 1659. We have more stone stones with a very intricate carvings. And this particular tower belongs to a Japanese woman. This belongs to a governor of Pulicat. The major large evidence is there. And then the intricate carvings, you can see how it is. And to see the scale, I'm just showing one hand here. And the entrance, a beautiful thing with the two skeletons on the side. Pulicat, still it is there, and it is under the protection of the ASI. Unfortunately, the older cemetery is not under the protection of ASI, so it is used as an open bar by the local people. Now I'm going to show you the other evidences. I don't want to bore you with Pulicat. There are many evidences on this coast for cotton trade. Bhumanipattanam, which is on near Vishakhapatnam, where the large Dutch, Portuguese, Danish trading were taking place. And it was equivalent to Phuket, but unfortunately we don't have any kind of buildings or drawings, only maps are there. Then we have Machilipatnam. I would say Machilipatnam is equivalent to the history of Phuket. Unfortunately, it is not there anymore as an evidence now, but we have a large fort factory, not a fort. And this is a picture I took it in about 2 years back. This is an abandoned store warehouse of the Dutch. This is the only warehouse existing today. Unfortunately, it is not under anybody's protection. Local people do drink over there, and I also had a fun over there. And this is a beautiful thing. And this is a big evidence, and this is a watchtower. And there were so many cemetery stone stones are left in Machilipatnam. To get to this place is not easy. This is away from Machilipatnam and called the Bandar. So unfortunately, or fortunately, I would say this has not been taken care much, even though it is under ASI. Machilipatnam still exists with a trade, which is called Kalamkari. Kalam with this thing, printing. Still they do it in a proper natural way. Few of them do this proper natural way. The carpenters are there to do this. It's the village called Pendana on the north of Machilipatnam or north of Bandar Fort. Unfortunately, due to, I don't know what the people are doing it for this corona lockdown. This is very dependent on our trade policies. We need to encourage them. Same kind of, this is had a long connection with Phuket. Through the Buckingham Canal, the goods were transported. Then I want to show the closer to Phuket region, Kalamkari, which is through pen. This is through block. This is through pen. Sri Kalakesti Kalamkari. They use natural dye and they use palm sugar, I think, to make the black color. This guy is a master craftsman. And I personally visited and saw their work. Wow, that is marvelous. Still few people are doing it. It all depends on our contribution. We need to revive this culture for the sustain. Yes, they sustain the nature. Through that, the culture is sustained and the India's cotton or India's identity is sustained. Then the mighty city called Madras, 1639. If I want to talk about cotton, I can talk about cotton in a long stretched 3-5 days talk with the cotton technique and everything. But I need to talk about this architecture only for this session called Icomos session. 1639, the Britishers took over the place called Mylapore, near to Mylapore, and they established Fort St. George. This is the first modern administration in India by the Europeans. Fort St. George established in 1639. Till today, we celebrated as the Madras week in during August. And to show the evidences, there are many evidences. I'm just showing a couple of things. The last church, 1516. Older than this, 1615, we have one church. We had one church in Phuket that was demolished in 2008. The funny history, 2008, they demolished it. 1515, it was demolished. The church built in Phuket was demolished in 2008. This is in Chennai. Last church in Mylapore, St. Mary's Church in the only and the largest, not only, the oldest Anglican church in Asia. Then one photograph showing the cotton weaving. And this is the Armenian church in Paris Corner in Chennai. I can't talk about Madras history because it's a long, big history. But the Britishers, to overpower the power, couldn't overpower the Dutch, so they settled with agreement with the Vijayanagara king in place called Madras. That's the fate of India changed. That's how the fate of India changed. Because they established everything in Madras first. They established the High Court, they established medical college, they established engineering college, they established everything, civil engineering college, everything. Even the municipal body first in the Commonwealth nations. Then this particular Indo-Saracenic architecture. Everything was established in this city only. And all because of this particular Madras chicks or cotton. And this guy is a famous president of the fort. And you can recognize this word, Yale, Yale University. This governor did a lot of mischief with the money. He started the, he funded the Yale University, opening of the Yale University. This is Madras High Court to show them the establishment of Madras institutions, which over took over the entire country, Calcutta, Delhi, and Mumbai also. I'm now going down south of Chennai, which is called as Sadras. So Sadras has got intact, and you can see the 1825, so that the structure still exists today, and we have all the things exist, and the godowns are still there, and it will be little bit maintained by the ASI, very well maintained. And luckily, there is no disturbance because it is located closer to the nuclear site, atomic power station. So nobody goes, no tourist visitors are frequenting there. So still it is in good shape. Then we have the most famous for everybody for a drink, it's Pondicherry. The French colony known for cotton. Pondicherry, yes, because I'm putting Pondicherry because they had a larger thing with the Madras. They French were occupying the Madras for 4 years due to the treaty they signed in England. They left Madras to the British during the 18th century. But the evidences are there in lot in Pondicherry. Due to the good governance, still the things are being protected and conserved. This is personally I visited Cuddalore, Fort David. Unfortunately, no evidences are existing because of the lack of interest by the administration. This is to prove you the importance still exists today. It's my photograph you see there. I'm wearing made out as a jibba. And this lady spinning, the slide has to open to show you the importance. This is unfortunately are being imported from China nowadays. So this is sad. Last few people exist still do and woven handloom lungi, which is very important for us to sustain this culture. But this particular endemic species are not there anymore. So it is all imported from China, but the handcraft is still there. But when we, if we can promote this, that will be a beautiful for our nature culture linkage. Then Faringipete, a sad note, no evidences, everything was demolished or destroyed due to our ignorance of conservation or ignorance of our history. But still few things are existing. And there's a mangroves, as you know, Port Nova, one of the oldest city in India occupied by the Portuguese. Then still there's another good thing is happening, which is called Tarangambadi. Due to the Danish government interference, Denmark, the port is the fort has been protected well, conserved well, and this monument, and this is the place where the first printing press also started in India. And still many things are due to the good work of Intac. The revival is happening and we will see a good things happening soon. Nagapattinam, the Dutch visited last year to do something over there for conservation of this cemetery. This is the commemoration of the British victory over the Napoleon. The Nagur Durga, you can see a lot of significance of the monument and this and this and this particular structure. And the Velangani Church, the Lady Mary's Church. And this is a Chola lighthouse without anybody's protection. It is lying to the coast, Kodikari. Nagapattinam lost everything due to the lack of our interest of conservation or history. Tuticorin, similar story. About 10 years back, the Dutch cemetery was completely demolished to make way for a playground, for a cricket ground. And all the stones were thrown nearby, which I personally took interest and showed to a couple of people and they took the interest. The church then took the stones and kept it in school. I don't know still it exists or not. And this is the most significant church of the Portuguese. Unfortunately, this is the extension which is done in a horrible way. It lost its character. This is the map of Tuticorin. Many things are destroyed, but few still exist. And this is a coral reef stone wall. And this is the VOC church still exists. Trinity, Holy Trinity Church of the Dutch, built in 1750. Unfortunately, recently something is happening over there due to bad conservation. And this place is close to the ancient port town called Korkai. My two talks, first was nature-culture linkage. Now I'm showing only the historical linkage which is left over. Yes, I spoken about the Indian side, but now I'm going to skip through the other connections we have still have in this subcontinent. Sri Lanka, Jaffna port, and then Galle port, which is got a big history with the Portuguese and Dutch due to the cotton. If you believe or not, Pulikat was the capital of this particular region till up to 1750s or 1770. Then we have Malaysia, a huge connection between Tamil and maritime trade still exists in Penang and Georgetown. And if I'm putting the slides for a certain reason, which I'll tell it in the end. Then we have big division connection between Singapore and the maritime trade with Indian region subcontinent. Of course, without Indonesia, there's no history of Dutch or a spice route. So Indonesia had a major connection between this region for maritime trade and particularly cotton trade, the batik style of cloth textile, and our Kalamkari cloth of style of textile also plays a major connection between either cotton trade. This is a funny thing which I came across in 2012 to show the Japanese trade link with India, particularly Pulikat. A couple of journalists from the Japan, from the country, they came here to make a documentation or documentary about our work. They came to know about us through the Embassy of Japan, and that is a big surprise because they said to me on the phone saying that they're coming for the gold trail. That is, they want to show, find the connection between Pulikat and this gold coin. But unfortunately, nowhere I couldn't find the coin, but they call it as a pagodas. They exchanged this coin for the cotton in India. Following them, about five people came from University of Tokyo to find the work in Pulikat, what we are doing, and they told many things about the trade links between Japan and India. They were exchanging gold for cotton, and the Dutch played a major role in it. So the gold came from Japan to Pulikat, minted in Fort Gilray and Pulikat, and taken to Netherlands. So this is a paper publication in Chennai. 2012 they came, and 2013 they published a documentary about us in Tokyo and telecasted in national TV also. Yes, so I think I bored you all with a lot of things about the connection, interconnections and everything, nature and cultural linkage. What is left over is the traces. After the independence, after the suppression or thing about happening in the Southeast Asian countries, people came back to India and they gave a lot of other cultural linkages also. This the trade traces still exist in India, in Chennai, in Chettinadu, in 20th century trade linkages, the palaces. You might have all seen this popular in cinemas and everything. Thousands of palaces, and many are getting demolished due to the poverty and also for the high price people pay for the stones and the wood. So the question mark is, do we not to start the campaign for cotton route? Of course, it's well documented thing, but very less known to the people. So we need to come up with a cotton route as a promotion. More than spice, cotton was surviving this country for many centuries. Unfortunately, due to many ignorant things, it is killed. If we can revive with good policies, we will become mighty. So what now? With our promotion, due to, it was support of Jayalalitha Madam, Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu, we did a campaign for the World Heritage nomination. A team from Nicomos also came during the meeting, but long back, recently, it is not happening anything on happening on that. What now? Cotton route is to revive the nature, because cotton route is not the same old ships or anything. Bringing back the tourism or bringing back the monuments, we'll bring back the nature with that, because every fort or port located close to the estuary, when estuary is revived, or the fort is revived or protected, the water body needs to be protected. With that, culture will be protected. And if we can revive that with the cotton seeds, indigenous cotton seeds, the handloom textile industry will be revived. The indigenous textile industry will revive. Then we will be welcoming thousands of flamingos and snipe birds. Then we will be inviting dolphins and sharks, which are being killed in the last 50 years due to pollution in this Coromandel coast, due to which we are getting less rain. And we'll bring back the coral, for which it's a very complicated nomination which we are proposing. It is called transnational nomination, or at least a serial nomination along the Coromandel coast for the World Heritage. But long journey, how long, I don't know. So let us see. And with this last slide, I want to finish. I want to ask that answer, which I, unfortunately, I'm not able to see the slide. Hello? Hello?
Yes, yes, Xavier. Yes, Xavier.
I got the last slide only now. My question to all, what was the color? Where the color came from?
You can see the chat box. There have been a couple of people who have responded to that. Some have said rust. Some have said base color is white.
Okay.
Someone has said about. Yes, go ahead. Okay. Go ahead. This you can read through the response.
It's none other than your mangroves. Mangrove gave the brown color. Unfortunately, due to the large export, the mangroves are killed in this coast. So now we can connect your mind with everything: nature, culture, ecology, mangroves, birds, trade, and everything. Wow, what a beautiful connection. So we need it back. Unfortunately, this is the identity of this country. This has been suppressed. This particular, we are very famous with silk route, we are famous with spice route, but the mighty cotton route has been suppressed. 80% of the commodity on any ship moved away from India is cotton. It's not spice. Thank you all for listening to me patiently, and now I'm ready to take any questions.
Thank you very much, Xavier. I think it's amazing how, like you said, a book changed the way people thought, and you kind of approached the subject, the one that you mentioned about the book becoming a change maker, to a date becoming a change maker, and to the fact that there are so many things and connections which we still are unaware about. And thanks a lot for bringing it to our, I'm sure we can do a whole series, like you said, of 3 to 5 days on just cotton and begin from there maybe. You were right. It's the beginning. It's the beginning of a new conversation which we will initiate through our NSC, ICOMOS, and through all the people whom we are now connecting with because of these presentations. And I will like to invite a few people who have pointed out. I think Poonam. Poonam is waiting to ask a question. Are you there, Poonam?
Hi. Good evening.
Hi.
Wow. So I lived in Pondicherry in Oroville for so many years and passed through these areas and never knew about this aspect of, this is really mind-boggling and it makes complete sense on the other side. I've always wondered why Chennai was the center, but I never got the answer. And today a lot many questions have been answered. So thank you so very much, Xavier. Wonderful to meet
you.
My question to you is, you know, the other place that is, from my mind, has been always the center, Maharashtra. And Amravati and Akola have been known as the biggest cotton markets, mandis cotton growers.
Yes.
So which cotton is that? That is one question. Second question is the Orissa belt, you know, the same way. I have recently become much more aware of the handloom industry. You raised very important questions about craft being the foundation of an economy. And we have such amazing, like Orissa, and there is Tarini, which has been weaving, and they have been able to weave at home in this COVID situation and then supply. There is a different chain altogether. So I would be very happy to connect you to one of my friends who's got an NGO, and that's how I came to know about it, that there is a model. But what is the connection of cotton to Orissa and to these weavers? Hello, can you still hear me?
Okay, yes. Yes, hello? I'm here.
Yes,
I'm able to hear you. I got your question. Yes,
yeah.
I got your questions. There are two questions in your thing. Thank you so much for the encouraging words. And my name Xavier Benedict itself is a big history because of the Portuguese connection. So that's
I'm also sitting in Goa and asking you these questions. So we will have a lot more interactions at another point in 1510. And people forget in the north that how older the whole situation, I mean, the story of India has to start from south and from the coast. If we are going to talk about anything, it cannot be Delhi, for instance, for any of it.
Yeah, it can't be Delhi because Delhi is only 1911.
It just cannot be, and people just don't realize it. So I'm very happy that these conversations are taking place now, you know. Yeah, please go ahead with the answers.
For the Mumbai, it is a Kutch cotton. Kutch cotton is very famous in those days. And but the history records all states after the Coromandel coast only. Because catching the coast, of course, the Arabians would have cast only the Kutch first. Mumbai, Goa, Cochin, then Sri Lanka, then coming to Chennai. Coromandel coast, because of the Chola Empire, due to the Pallava, Mahabalipuram, Kanchipuram and everything, it had a large trade. So the Kutch cotton, there are three types of cotton: Kutch region cotton, Coromandel coast cotton, then Dhaka, Calcutta region cotton. We might have had many indigenous species. Most of, I'm not against USA or America, most of the species have been taken out and thrown out and vanished or totally destroyed in this region. And I don't want to
but
put one slide.
Seeds?
You can see
unfortunately,
good number of people. Yes, there are good number of people are reviving the seeds back. Karingani, Kalingani, the cotton is there. Particularly the cotton which is used on the sail, they are reviving it now.
Okay.
These are all very unique cotton of the Coromandel coast. Kutch cotton was used for certain purposes. Coromandel cotton for cloth, handkerchief, bandana, and the sail. Dhaka cotton is almost like a sari. Orissa region was good in terms of this, as I said, this Peddana, Machilipatnam, Vishakhapatnam, and above up to Chilika. The trade was almost about the craft. The cloth is made, taken into the above, north of the southwest coast of India, and it has been neatly dyed and crafted for the kings and queens and the wealthy people. So Kalinga also played a major role, but the Chola Empire had the biggest foundation for everything. And the bad foundation was taken in the age of 1715 onwards, when the America took over the entire cotton production. By 1815, India was the poorest country in the world without any. And if you take the history, there's a big history between Somalia and India and Ethiopia. Somalia was the richest nation. Now it is the poorest nation in the world because of our trade policies. Okay, so that's Kutch, just to answer the thing, Kutch cotton and the craft major plays a major role. And behind my, I'm sitting in the room, behind me you can see a palm leaf craft also. So that is also one of the economic empowerment in Coromandel coast.
Thanks a lot.
Which will connect
with
economy.
Wonderful to meet you.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Muslin, there's one, Yasmin is asking a question called muslin. Yes, muslin is a word started with Machilipatnam. Palayakat, the word palayakat is nothing but pulicat. If you go to Mexico, they still call it as palayakat. And if you can't enter Mecca without palayakat lungi. If you ask a Muslim person, you will say they bought a palayakat in Mecca. The funny thing, they will not know where is palayakat. Till today, I'm talking about today. So palayakat is the cloth they wear it for Mecca. And it is made in Indonesia. Today, all the cloth which is sold in Mecca are made in Indonesia.
Mr. Teja? Yeah, if hello? Yes.
It's a great presentation, firstly. So there is a territorial and cover effect, which is French, British, and Dutch settlement. Why these four towns lose their importance as though there is a trading for a longer time? Why suddenly it was dropped?
Okay, why suddenly it is blocked? Hello? I'm not there. Am I audible?
Yes.
Your question is
why they lost their
how
importance.
This trade is stopped.
Why they lost their importance.
Okay.
Yeah.
Why nobody lost that importance? We were made to lose the importance. If you give me a one-day talk, I can talk about the significance of the 1825 Tambora eruption, then the establishment of the empires. They are mighty empire to rule the world and to make money in Europe through the cotton as well as other things like rice and gold and silver. And because nothing will grow in this other part of the world, northern global north, and the great America. And World War I, World War II systematically killed the global south. And I'm not afraid of putting the word. And to establish the growth, the United Nations was created. I'm not afraid of telling this, but history shows how it was global south were made into poor country because of certain multinational established institutions. So we didn't lose anything. We lost because of our science is looked upon in a Western way. Science should be looked upon in a vernacular way. Then we can revive it very well, our economy and our design.
Thank you.
Can I answer the question? There's one question from Swadi Subramaniam. Curious to know Pallikat Sabari Malaki. Can I answer that?
Sure, go ahead.
Okay, most of us will know Sabarimala, and Sabarimala's became very popular in last 1 year of news channel debate. Okay, Pallikat means when you are going to Sabarimala, first you have to put a Pallikat on your head. So the origin is Pallikat. Pallikat because Pallikat is the cloth name, it's not the place. So whatever originated from the Pallikat region is called Pallikat. Pallikat or a Palayakat. In Malaysia, it is called Palayakat. In Mecca, it is called in Spanish, it is called Palayakat, Palayakat, Pallikat, Pallikat. So Swati Subramaniam, you would have got to know what it is now.
Yes, Xavier, you can pick and choose your questions you see in the chat box. I have lost track a little bit.
Okay.
So there was
Kalingam,
somebody
yes,
asking.
Kalingam.
Go ahead.
Tell me. No, I don't know. You just tell me what the question is.
No, there was somebody asking about Viking roots on your last slide.
Okay. Viking roots, nothing got to do with us. Just I'm showing what are the famous roots. We know what is the street name in New York, but we will not know what is the street name in Chennai or Delhi. So Viking roots is very famous. But I'm talking about the roots of which is famous and the World Heritage status comes to them. We need World Heritage status for cotton root to get back the nature-culture linkage. That's what I was mentioning it that. And that too, I'm mentioning the first slide answer in the last slide, putting mangroves into it. So mangroves played a major role.
Yes, I think there was somebody asking Mr. Gyan.
Steven Beckett. Yes, Gyan.
He was asking about hello, can you hear me?
Yes,
I'm
here.
Audible.
Yes.
I'm
yes.
Audible.
Yes, sir.
Hi.
Yes.
Thanks, Xavier. We have been interacting a lot at a different forum many times. So thank you so much for the wonderful talk. I have just like a a very not a technical question, but a very generalized sort of a question, that how this is the entire historical cotton route. And we are very much aware, as you already told, that the heritage of the country was very rich. But with the recent development of the new fiber, polyester, how would you say that how this polyester changed the entire trajectory of the mindset of the Indian society to become more westernized than to be more vernacular in nature? So what would you like comment on that? How it changed the entire the thought process of the country in terms of modern versus versus vernacular? I would say modern versus old.
Okay. Thanks for the question, but there are a lot of political things behind it. And as you know, petroleum byproduct is the polyester. So the fossil fuel promotes polyester. So you know where it stands, where it is linked with, which business group is promoting it. The largest producer of plastic is in this country only. So this particular polyester been promoted because of fashion, because we have multiple colors. We can print the computer style things on the cloth, and it's the cheapest. It is not handmade, machine made.
Right.
So you can you can make thousands of meters in per minute.
Right. So I think there lies the answer towards the Western way of thinking and a vernacular way of thinking of of how this fiber changed the entire mindset of the society, basically the Indian society, in terms of the southern richness and heritage what we had in the past. So I think we missed the boat somewhere to see that what culture and heritage we had in terms of the shiny things what we had in the recent past. So I think we need to really think over it very seriously and bring back the entire old cultural heritage which we had.
Thanks for your comment.
Yeah,
but one thing I need to add, it is not only India, every region had its own nature culture linkage. Only problem was, are you putting the nature in the center of the economy, or are you putting the capital into the center of the economy?
There you have hit the
nature based economy a capital-based economy. Only that's the game changer after World War II.
True, very true. I completely agree with you, Xavier.
Thank you.
And I again thank you for that such a wonderful and comprehensive talk. Although many of my questions were answered already in your presentation. And thank you so much. Thank you so much, Tapan. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yes, Xavier, you can take last two questions. One is from Jatin.
Jatin, what was the position of Egyptian cotton trade during the period of... Egyptian cotton, it's a delta cotton, and same as the Coromandel cotton. Egyptian were wearing the white cloth, and Ethiopian, Egyptian, Somalians were wearing the type of cloth, which this Coromandel region also got a connection. Here I have to put, don't take it in a wrong sense. Here I have to say the pyramidal structure of the temple also got a connection with the Egyptian style of construction. So this cotton trade brought in many things. The Egyptian cotton were very, what happened was there is a historically due to certain cultural change and the religious change happening in the 8th and 9th century, Egyptian cotton lost a little bit of trade. By the time 8th century, Chola Empire was expanding, so our cotton became famous. And our particular Coromandel cotton is particularly one kind of cotton is very strong, so which can withstand the, say, a long distance travel by sea. Egyptian cotton is a fine, good cotton for wearing cloth, but not for sale. So Coromandel cotton played two roles, for cloth as well as tail of the ship. But Coromandel cotton has had a many varieties, species. Today we are only seeing a couple of species only, many varieties. I think that would answer your thing. So Egyptian cotton was a fine quality of cotton. Due to certain things happening in the Arab region, they lost the trade by the time Chola picked it up. Then there's a question
by Shyam Kumar Puravankaraya.
Yes. Pulikat and British, I have been in connection. I am from Kerala, also curious to know where our cotton threads came from. Of course, British's Vijayanagara king played a major role in inviting, or I would say not Vijayanagara, Nayaks played a major role in allowing all the Europeans to establish their trade factories in India. And in that, many cotton came. For Kerala, I would say it is only from Coromandel coast, because the land route between Kerala and Coromandel side was exhaustive and it was gone through only by the Arabs. There are many mosques, or there are stone mosques, Kalpalli in Solvo. Their stone mosques are still available, are still there in the Western Ghats. So this cotton which you are seeing in Kerala came from the Coromandel side. It could have been from the Tanjavur belt. Tanjavur belt had a major cotton growing thing, and also rice growing. So it was.
Xavier, your voice is breaking. Can you just repeat the last line?
Pathway to the Kerala and the down south, Teni path. Were doing the trade, and same time Arabs were doing the trade, and the cotton which you are seeing in Kerala is none other than the Coromandel cotton. Mostly would have been coming from the Tanjavur, because there are good number of mosques located in the Western Ghats, river side of Western Ghats region, where the pathway to Kerala is located. So the Labbes and the Marakkayas were doing the trade between the Kerala and the Coromandel coast. Thank you.
Thank you, Xavier. I'd like to invite Gurmeet to talk about her question, her thoughts. Gurmeet, you're still there?
Yes, I am.
Yes.
Sure, Xavier, this was a lovely talk, huh? These are just new areas for the so-called North Indians. Now, you know what occurs to me from the talk, from what Rakhit gave and yourself, and it came out very strongly in yours, and my question and something for collective thinking would be that, should we be looking at production and trade as a line of inquiry to map heritage routes, to link the past with the present and into the future? You know, the point is that what you have brought out very strongly in your presentation, and it seems that seems to be your area of work, is to work with intangible heritage very closely, and especially people's livelihoods. And I mean, one would imagine that this, what I keep hearing, what Richard Engelhardt mentions, is that, you know, we keep talking about the legacies of princes, politicians, and priests, which is, we talk about empires and palaces and temples and forts and all that, but all this came about because the backbone of all this was production and trade. And it's the people's see which led to the creation of this wealth that got managed by and struck, you know, by the princes, and the priests created another structure of, you know, management of people. Bottom line is, the real producers still today are suffering. So I was just one interesting line of inquiry, you know, for heritage roots in India, because we know that people were drawn to India because of what we were producing for thousands of years. But bring it to today. What do you think?
Yes. So you got all the answers to the question you are raising. The production played a major role. Yes, of course, production, because we are good in craft. We are good in weaving. Our technique of weaving was unbeatable for almost 2000 years. Only the mechanization we lost in. And that too because of our very naive nature of believing in white skin. So I'm not against racism or anything. I'm not saying white skin, because we started admiring a lot of things. And tangible, intangible, of course, the both have got a nature-culture linkage. Without nature, there's no tangible. Without nature, there's no intangible. So the craft played a major role. You were mentioning about the princes and queens, and of course, one of the major reasons for the British to leave Chennai or Madras to Calcutta, then to Delhi, was the production or the power to do business. Chennai was, or the Coromandel Coast was completely covered up with the Chettiars or the communities of Marakayas and Labbes and all Rediyas. They were doing lots of business with other region of the world. Britishers were new, so they were not able to do anything. So they were going to the princely states, because this south of southeast coast of India was governed by Nayaks. Nayaks were promoting the cotton on individual village basis, not even town basis. When they were going on the northern side, they found the princely state as a power to easily empower everything. So Britishers, one of the reasons for Britishers to move, there are many histories says that Britishers moved for cyclone reason and everything. But the main reason is they were not able to do the good profitable business because the competition was very high in south. Then they moved to Calcutta, then the mainland, Delhi. So that is the princely history also written after that. We are understanding all the East story as a princely history only. The South story is forgotten or hidden.
Hope I thank you so much. That's
thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. If you are up to answering some more questions, then
I don't have any issues.
There is Diksha. Diksha is asking a question about the communities and Bandar Cotton.
What is the question, Diksha?
In Machilipatnam, there are still communities existing who are involved in making Bandar Cotton. What are your views on it?
Yes, they should, but what kind of cotton? And Machilipatnam, I personally say I love that place so much because they're still able to retain the craft. But the cotton, what kind of cotton? Are they doing it a indigenous endemic species or the American Montanzana, what I forgot the company name, supplied cotton, hybrid seed cotton. To sustain, to get good rains, to use less chemicals, you need indigenous, the Coromandel as well as the Andhra Pradesh cotton. There are so much of Andhra Pradesh cottons are lost, so we have to revive it. Machilipatnam is doing their best in craft. If they can bring in the indigenous seed, that will make a big game change in our modern after COVID economy. Hello, Tappan, your voice is not audible.
Yes. So Xavier, thank you very much. I think that brings us to the end of questions. And I think what has been amazing is that we have covered right from north to south and like tried to cover the diverse nature of our region, of our nation, and come up with these cultural roots as our specific case studies. And I'm sure there are many more which will emerge through our dialogue, and I really look forward to our interaction within the committee and look forward to a wonderful audience which was there through all our presentations. And we'll come up with a new series soon. In the meanwhile, the recordings will also be shared on Facebook and maybe YouTube, so we'll keep you posted about that. Okay, one last comment. Poonam is asking, why World Heritage Site?
You see the link. That's what I told in the last word. We need a World Heritage connection between the tangible, intangible, nature, culture, fort and monuments. Fort and monuments are there to prove that there is a cotton route. When we can do it for Viking, spice route and everything, why not for this? Easily can do. And there are so much of transnational linkages. So much of campaign can be done for the India identity called cotton route. Actually, I need to mention one thing. The dress I am wearing today is a indigenous local endemic species cotton, and that is from the Coromandel Coast. So that also I need to prove that. So this Nare is very important for the World Heritage. And it should be a serial nomination if we are not able to do the transnational nomination. I'm very new to the ICOMOS. I need to understand the integrity in it of all the ICOMOS terminologies, which will I will understand it in a couple of years.
Just to the reason, because we have World Heritage Site here, which is a convent, and it's been one of the early ones. The state it is in, it's just so disheartening, so terrible. Just a few buildings are not being able to looked after, you know. So I've been wondering, why don't we go right from the, see, each of these, I understand, and the value is so much more. So why not involve our own collectors, our magistrates, or our panchayats, and get them to understand the value, because it is directly going to, you know, make a difference to the life of the people who are living in these areas. Going to UNESCO, making all these documents, and at the end of it, ASI has to be involved, all these authorities have to be involved, and transnational means so many, all those kind of geopolitical situations which never percolates down. So I'm sitting in Goa looking at this World Heritage Site, which we are, it is a mess, means it is a complete mess. So I'm seriously wondering why anybody wants a, you know, World Heritage Site. I mean, one has to really look at it, and there are some 20 sites I have been to which are equally bad. So this is one. And as you said, you know, Intac was able to work in Trampaka when Ajit took him, he took it on himself, you know, and the amount of work he has done. Yeah, good friend of mine, and is just believing in it, and he went to the corridors of powers in our own country from one office to the other, just keep talking about it. When you're so convinced, Xavier, you have done the work, get the team together, take small, and let us find a way to actually get the work going. Tags can come. I'm not saying don't do the parallel work, but let's just forget about it. That is the most important aspect, because what we are seeing is it just doesn't make any difference to ASI. Who will look after all this transnational? Just buildings are not being looked after. So my request to you is that you're sitting on something which is, you know, you're doing all this work. Let's get more people involved in it. Let's ourselves become so much more passionate about it that they have to say, oh, yes, please take the tag, you know. You really are World Heritage. This is where we need to go, and not ask them to give it to us.
Okay. Thanks. Thank you. Thank you. Definitely. Thank you so much. Thanks for the encouragement.
Yeah. Thank you, Poonam. I think that's a very, very powerful. Yeah, it's a very powerful mode. I think sharing is one of the ways in which we can really address this gap of trying to get our local community and more people involved in the whole process. And we really look forward to doing that. And I hope ICOMOS will offer that support to all our work. And look forward to everybody. Thank you again, Xavier. And thank you for the wonderful audience. And we look forward to many more such series and sharing soon.